A very good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship service for today, Sunday, the 7th of February, whether you're watching us live at 10 a.m. or later. I am Tony Bartlett, one of our licensed lay ministers, and let me introduce our team. We have our vicar, Reverend Jill Rowell, who will be preaching.
Morning, everyone.
We have Hazel Newman.
Morning.
And Sonia Ludford.
Hello, everybody.
Who are bringing our Bible readings, and Caroline Heron, our intercessions.
Morning.
Unseen, lurking in the background, is Stuart Poor, who is recording and editing the service so that you can see and hopefully hear us. It is our hope that during the next hour or so, you will join with us in worship and prayer that will inspire, encourage and draw you closer to our loving God. Whilst you'll also be hearing from our singers and musicians, our first song of worship is a commercial recording from Resound Worship, which invites us to come and worship Christ, the King, our Saviour, King of Glory. From a fairly new hymn of praise back to the 1950s and my school days. I was reminded recently of a hymn that we used to sing at our morning school assemblies. I've got my old school hymn book somewhere. It was issued on our first day at secondary school. The first two verses of that hymn that I remember so well are these. New every morning is the love, our wakening and uprising prove, through sleep and darkness safely brought, restored to life and power and thought. New mercies each returning day hover around us while we pray. New perils past, new sins forgiven, new thoughts of God, new hopes of heaven. The psalm set for today also pictures the wonderful world that we wake to every day, created and enjoyed by God, left in our care to enjoy, not to despoil and destroy. So this is verses 26 to 35 from Psalm 104, and I'm reading from the Message translation. What a wildly wonderful world, God! You made it all with the wisdom at your side, made earth overflow with your wonderful creations. Oh, look, the deep, wide sea, bringing with fish past counting, sardines and sharks and salmons. Ships plough those waters, and Leviathan, your pet dragon, romps in them. All the creatures look expectantly to you to give them their meals on time. You come, and they gather around. You open your hand, and they eat from it. If you turned your back, they'd die in a minute. Take back your spirit, and they die. Revert to original mud. Send out your spirit, and they spring to life, the whole countryside in bloom and blossom. The glory of God, let it last forever. Let God enjoy his creation. He takes one look at earth and triggers an earthquake, points a finger at the mountains and volcanoes erupt. Oh, let me sing to God all my life long, sing hymns to my God as long as I live. Oh, let my song please him. I'm so pleased to be singing to God. But clear the ground of sinners, no more godless men and women. Oh, my soul, bless God. Continuing that creation theme, our next hymn links dawn, evening, and the wonders of creation with the promise of that new creation, that new heaven and new earth, foretold in the book of Revelation when Jesus returns.
Creation sings the Father's song. It calls the sun to wake the dawn and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson rays. His fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning globe. He charts the eagle's flight and commands the newborn baby's cry. Creation stand and sing, Alleluia. Fill the earth with songs of worship, tell the wonders of creation's King. Creation gazed upon his face, the ageless one in time's embrace, unveil the Father's plan of reconciling God and man. The second Adam walked the earth, whose blameless life would break the curse, whose death would set us free to live with him eternally. Alleluia! Let all creation stand and sing. Alleluia! Songs of worship tell the wonders of creation's King. Creation longs for his return, when Christ shall reign upon the earth. The bitter wars that rage are birth pains of a coming age. He renews the land and sky, all heaven will sing and earth reply, with one resplendent theme, the glory of our golden King. Alleluia! Let all creation and sing. Hallelujah! Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's King. Hallelujah! Let all creation stand and sing. Hallelujah! Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's King.
Please join in the words in bold as we now declare God's wisdom and rule. Blessed are you, Lord God, King of the universe. Your word brings on the dusk of evening. Your wisdom creates both night and day. You determine the cycles of time. You arrange the successions of the seasons and establish the stars in their heaven courses. Lord of the starry hosts is your name. Living and eternal God, rule over us always. Blessed be the Lord, whose word makes evening fall. And now Hazel, then Sonia, bring our two Bible readings.
The first reading this week is from Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 20. Christ is the same as God. No one can see God, but Jesus is exactly like God. Jesus rules over everything that has been made. Through his power, all things were made, things in heaven and on earth, seen and not seen, all spiritual rulers, lords, powers, and authorities. Everything was made through Christ and for Christ. He was there before anything was made, and all things continue because of him. Christ is the head of body, which is the church. He is the beginning of everything else, and he is the first amongst all who will be raised from the dead. So in everything, he is most important. God was pleased for all of himself to live in Christ. And through Christ, God was happy to bring all things back to himself again, things on earth and things on heaven. God made peace by using the blood sacrifice of Christ on the cross.
Our second reading is written in John chapter 1, verses 1 to 14. The Word became flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
In the beginning was the Word made flesh. Jesus, who was with God in the beginning, and he is the name above all names.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. In hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you on Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want to come without us. So Jesus, you brought me.
Jesus to you. You might say he's your saviour, your redeemer, or you might say he's a prophet, a priest, or king. You might say he's your best friend or Lord, any or all of these things and lots more besides. You might say he's a great moral and spiritual and ethical teacher, and you might say he's God incarnate, or even I don't know. How many of you would say, as John's Gospel begins, that he is the Word through whom all things were made? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. Wow. We usually read John 1 at Christmas, but reading it today, doesn't it immediately make you ask yourself where you've heard that phrase before? In the beginning. And you and John's original audience would have realized that John is alluding to Genesis and the story of creation. Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." And what is amazing is that John recognizes that Jesus is the Word through whom all creation was made. In Genesis, the story of creation, when God spoke, things came into being. And then Jesus, who was with God in the beginning, becomes part of that creation later on when we come to first century New Testament times. Isn't that just mind-boggling? So it's not just John's gospel that claims this. Colossians 1:15 tells us that the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And we haven't got time to do it now, but I would encourage you to read Proverbs 8, which is all about wisdom. And Old Testament wisdom is vital to our understanding of God. But when we get to the New Testament, Jesus is the one who is seen as that wisdom manifested. Anyway, he's before all things, and in him all things hold together. These are just such profound words. And if we really take them to heart, what other option do we have but to bow the knee and worship the Lord and respond like the disciples did when Jesus calmed the storm and say, "Who is this? Who is this?" Colossians goes on to say in verses 19 to 20, "For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him," that's Jesus, "and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross." To reconcile to himself all things, things on earth and things in heaven. Why was that necessary? Why do all things need reconciling? Because our world is broken, it's fallen, and the account in Genesis 3 is all about the fall, which is a travesty. This beautiful creation made for us to enjoy is fallen. And today we can easily recognize that it's being damaged and destroyed by greed, ignorance, and thoughtlessness. And yet, God is at work reconciling and restoring it through Jesus. So for me, this says I need a much bigger view of Jesus. That Jesus didn't just come to reconcile me with my Father in heaven, or you with your Father in heaven, but to reconcile and restore all things. So that's far more than just us people, all things. Jesus came to begin the restoration of the world to how God intended it to be, to make all things new, to reverse what happened in the fall. And Jesus values creation and shows us how creation reveals the love of the Father and brings restoration and healing, uniting everything back with God. So we can have hope. Because of Jesus' death on the cross, all things can be made new. Everything sin has broken and corrupted is being restored and reconciled to God through Jesus. However, global warming calls us to rethink the way we understand God and God's love for us and for the whole creation. How does God feel when innocent people suffer loss due to natural calamities? How does God feel when we exploit nature to satisfy our greed, and pleasure? What is our responsibility as God's children? Jesus invites us to participate in his mission in this world, and we're invited as his people, his family, to join in with him in this ministry of reconciliation. And I believe this is the fullness of the whole gospel, to join in with Jesus in his ministry of reconciliation. We are rightly devastated by the horrendous scale of the number of COVID deaths. In the UK, as I write, it's over 109,000. Worldwide, 2.3 million. I'm so glad that the archbishops have called the nation to pray every day at 6 o'clock. We are rightly concerned at all the suffering that has been caused by the coronavirus and the impact of it. Not being able to be with loved ones or care for them, to be alongside them when they've died, children missing opportunities for normal development and family relationships, grandparents separated from family members, people lonely, isolated and fearful, and the economic pressures on those who've lost their jobs, and the pressures on all of us having to live our lives differently, limitedly, all because of this unseen, unknown terror that has spread across the world in a relentless and subversive manner. And I don't want to belittle any of that this morning. We are all feeling the effects. But let me say this. Climate change is far, far more serious. It is already hitting people in poverty the hardest, with rising sea levels, pollution, deforestation, weird weather affecting all areas of the globe. And some say it's due to climate change that we have the coronavirus anyway. Now, God calls us to love him and to love our neighbours. So even if we don't care about climate change for ourselves, and I'm reminded here of my mum, who we were shopping in Marks and Spencer one day. She was in her wheelchair and this lady selling electricity came to her and said, Madam, do you care about climate change and global warming? And mum looked at her and said, no, not really. Even if we don't care about climate change for ourselves, we need to care about it. One, because God cares about it. He made the world good and he was very pleased with what he had made. And two, because of others, for those living in other parts of the world, the effects of climate change that are affecting them more severely, and our young ones and our future generations. So sometimes we can feel paralyzed or overwhelmed because it's all just too much. And because we can't do everything, we end up doing nothing. But I think we have a simple choice to make today. We can choose to live differently and we can encourage others to live differently too. During Lent, which is just a couple of weeks away, we at St. Catherine's are going to be focusing on our response to climate change. If you receive our notice sheet, you will already have seen that Hazel is putting an idea each week to remind us of what we can do, what habits we can nurture to make a positive difference to our world. So please read it and take action. Our midweek morning prayer services are going to focus on God's creation too. And already the PCC are beginning to consider what steps we need to take to become an eco-church. And I'm appealing for your support and encouragement as we move forward. And what's more, I'm going to be encouraging you all to read a book. It's called Just Living, Faith and Community in an Age of Consumerism, and it's written by Ruth Valerio. So we need to really think about living simply and choosing to live simple lives. Of course, there's lots of other organisations and people focusing on this just now, so we're not alone. But the question has to be, what are we doing? Are we joining in? And I'd like us as a church to take responsibility and to play the part that we can to lessen the impact of climate change. Tear Fund, Christian organisation, and the Climate Coalition are calling on the UK government to lead the world in delivering a post-COVID recovery that is healthier, greener and fairer, and which puts us on track to tackle climate change. Our own MP, Alex Sharma, has been appointed full-time president of COP26, taking place in Glasgow this November, the 26th United Nations Climate Change Conference. And I'm so pleased that on St. Catherine's behalf, one of our prayer team, you'll remain anonymous, has written to him to tell him that we shall be praying for him regularly as he takes on this hugely influential role. And of course, our own diocese and the COE are taking this very seriously, encouraging churches to work towards being carbon neutral over the next decade. And that actually is a very short time span. We don't have time to spare. The matter is urgent and we are called into action. Now, as I'm speaking, I realise I'm not a scientist and I'm not an environmentalist. I'm just a little old vicar seeking to do my bit to galvanise us into action as we seek to act justly, love mercy and walk humbly with our God. But some of you listening today may have more vision, more time, more inclination to really move things forward. And you might be feeling a great big nudge from God to do something, which I hope you are, at a local level here at St. Catherine's or in our wider society in Tilehurst, in Reading or nationally. And if you feel like that, let me encourage you to get moving this morning. So I'm going to finish as I began and ask, who is Jesus to you? As co-heirs with Christ, we must do all we can to halt the devastation which climate change is bringing on our world, this planet, and this wonderful creation. Shall we pray? Father God, we thank you for the beauty of creation. As your people, help us to play our part in healing and redeeming it as we witness to the love of Jesus, our healer and redeemer. Amen.
Thank you, Jill. We all have a part in misusing God's creation. Let's take a moment to allow God to remind us of the excessive demands that we make on creation. Demands that are overusing the resources of earth and affecting not only the lives of those most unable to cope, but generations to come. If we are serious about living simply, to tread lightly on earth, then we need to ask for God's forgiveness for the past and help for the future. So we come now to a time of confession, and please join in the words in bold after each section. We confess our sin and the sins of our society in the misuse of God's creation. God our Father, we are sorry for the times when we have used your gifts carelessly and acted ungratefully. Hear our prayer, and in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We enjoy the fruits of the harvest, but sometimes forget that you have given them to us. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We belong to a people who are full and satisfied, but ignore the cry of the hungry. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We are thoughtless and do not care enough for the world you have made. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We store up goods for ourselves alone, as if there were no God and no heaven. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. And as we bring those things to mind, we pray that God will forgive us. Almighty God, who in Jesus Christ has given us a kingdom that cannot be destroyed, forgive us our sins, open our eyes to God's truth, strengthen us to do God's will, and give us the joy of his kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now Caroline will lead us in a time of prayer.
Let's pray. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. In the beginning, just darkness, emptiness, no world, no people, no time, just nothing. And God spoke to create the world. He created the sky by day, red at sunset, blue in sunshine, dark with rain. He created the sky by night, the silvery light of the moon and the billion twinkling stars in the inky darkness. The pounding sea, waves sparkling in sunlight, white capped in storms, the sound of its breakers on shingle and sand. And then the pattern on a butterfly's wings, the colours of a duck's feathers, and the different shapes of leaves on a tree. And amazingly, God created us and delights in us and came to live among us. So, Creator God, we come to you in prayer. Give us your love for the whole of creation. Creator God, we have misused your creation. We've taken your earth's resources for granted. Our cars have guzzled fossil fuels. Our planes have eroded the ozone layer. We've enjoyed cheap goods and convenient lifestyles made possible by the exploitation of those in need. We have stripped the earth bare, leaving nothing for our grandchildren. And we've caused glaciers to retreat and polar bears to die. Help our leaders to make the right and courageous decisions about our world, so that all forms of life may continue to flourish and future generations may learn of your greatness through the world's wonders, and inspire us to work with others to influence our leaders. And we bring before you particularly Alex Sharma, our MP, in his position as president of the November COP26 conference in Glasgow. And we pray those attending may be prepared to take the big steps to use the world's resources for the good of the whole community of life, to sustain rather than destroy. And we bring before you the pandemic. We struggle to understand the reasons behind coronavirus. Yet we know that in the midst of this, your love is shown in the compassion and selflessness of so many. Medical profession, supermarket workers, delivery people, and so many others. We thank you for the hope you have given us with the development and the distribution of the vaccines, and ask for wisdom to ensure a fair distribution of the vaccine to rich and poor countries alike. So we Creator God, we ask that you would give us your love for the whole of creation. We pray for your worldwide church in all its diversities. We pray especially for those churches who meet in difficult and dangerous circumstances. And at the time of the pandemic, for all those churches that cannot meet in person, but only online. We thank you for the blessing of the team here at St. Catherine's who work so hard to provide all our services and activities online, for the encouragement that Jill and Phil provide, and for the opportunity to learn about the Bible in our weekly course. May we and all your church feel your abiding presence to uphold our courage and strengthen our faith, so that we may live in loving unity with one another, knowing you delight in each one of us. And as we move towards Lent, may we as individuals and a church use that time to reflect on the power of your love, that we may take steps to better protect the world and not prey on it, to sow beauty, not pollution and destruction. No darkness can overcome your light, though sometimes it seems that it is just darkness. But being part of the body of Christ, we can hold up your light for each other. We pray for those in our community who are sick, housebound, homeless, those juggling homeschooling and work, those in care homes, hospitals and hospices, and for the work of those who care for them. And we thank you for the example of those who have gone before us, and for all those who feel the pain of grief at the loss of a loved one. And we thank you particularly for the national inspiration of Captain Tom, who died this week, who through last year encouraged us all with what he achieved and his perseverance despite his frailties. And in a moment of silence, we remember those on our heart today. Almighty Father, if we did not worship, you would still be God. If we did not hear, you would still have spoken. If we did not praise you, you would still be God above all gods, creator of all that is, of all that has been, and all that is to come. And so as we go into next week, may we by faith walk in your restoring love with new hope, new strength, new courage, and a new start, following your call to radical actions, to care about your whole created world, and to share resources equitably with all life. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we finish our intercessions by saying together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And now we'll sing, or hear our singers sing, Lord, for the years, that well-known song which starts off talking about all the good things that God has done for us. And then it finishes with a great affirmation of the fact that Jesus will be glorified.
Nearing the end of our service, so that means it's the notices. They are all on the email I sent out yesterday. If you don't receive that weekly email, just ask through our website and we'll add you to the list of subscribers. So this is just a reminder that there's something online every day at 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. You can also catch up on Cat's Cartoon Club that happened yesterday, and R&R, which happens every Saturday morning. To come, it's the Mothers Union meeting on Wednesday at 2:30, and everyone is invited to come along on Zoom to that talk. as Jill has mentioned in her sermon, climate change has to be addressed. And as a church, we're pushing forward with the Eco Church agenda. If you have ideas and would like to be involved, please do get in touch, again through our website. And if you missed it, Jill had recommended a book which may help. I think it's quite a big read, and it's about £4, and it's called Just Living, Faith and Community in an Age of Consumerism by Ruth Valerio. And I'll get Stuart to put the link to that. You can buy it, I'm sure, at any good bookshop, but there's an online retailer who I know has it in stock. And our final prayer now. May God, who clothes the lilies and feeds the birds of the sky, who leads the lambs to pasture and the deer to water, who multiplied loaves and fishes and changed water into wine, lead us, feed us, multiply us, and change us to reflect the glory of our Creator through all eternity. Amen. So before we close down and join you hopefully for our Zoom coffee, we're going to strike up our coffee mugs, and here's mine. And I thought that, inspired by Jill's sermon, we might think about how we could become more green in our daily living. Can we become eco people as well as an eco church? So Jill, what are your ideas?
For a long time now, I've been walking to church.
Oh, that's nothing.
So you don't know, I sort of live in the church car park. I do all the things that I think most of us do in terms of recycling, you know, plastics and milk bottle tops and bottles and tins and all the rest of it. I suppose clothes. I try to be, not exactly frugal, but I will always recycle clothes. Like, I would always take them to a charity shop. It's not innovative, but it is something I always do. And I also am a vegetarian, but again, that's not because of green. It's just because I went off meat. So I'm sorry, that's my inspiration for now, but I'm looking forward to learn on how. And also, I have a diesel car, which at the time my brother bought it, you know, we thought we were doing great guns, but it's no good now. So I will have to replace it with an electric car soon.
Yeah. I'm saving Hazel to last because you've got something on the notice sheet that I know is a good idea. So I'll go to Sonia now. Sonia, what do you think you could do?
I think last Christmas, my niece gave me some plastic stretchy covers, you know, for food containers. Right. So I do use those really regularly as a replacement for cling film. Mm. I do have cling film in the cupboard. I do use it as occasionally. Well, I try not to, but some things I have to. But I really try and use the stretchy covers a lot. And I mean, again, do all the same things. Turn off the tap when you're cleaning your teeth, you know, turning it on again, all of that sort of stuff, and just general recycling. But, you know, just the normal things, really, like Jill.
Thank you. That's an idea for the notice sheet, Hazel. Stretchy covers.
I've got that covered in a future one. Right. About 2 months worth.
Let's go to Caroline next, shall we? Hello, Caroline.
Yeah, so I'm probably a little bit like Sonia and Jill, in that I do all the sort of usual things. And, you know, it's the big things that are so hard to do, like getting solar panels or an electric car. So I suppose the two small things that I'm a bit challenged by now is, one is the cling film one that Sonia's talked about. And the other one is I live in Reading Council, and they've just introduced the food bins. So I'm beginning to, I'm at the stage now where, you know, you crack an egg and you sort of don't think, and you put it into the ordinary bin, and then you're stretching in and getting it out of the ordinary bin and putting it in the food bin. So I'm trying to get used to using the food bin.
Thank you. Yes, I think like the others, we're trying to reduce consumption. It's, you know, a question of saving money as well, isn't it? And we've had food caddies in West Berkshire for some time. I was interested in Jill's comment about clothes because some while ago I posted some pictures on Facebook of my retirement present 25 years ago, and I've still got the same bike, and I was wearing the same t-shirt that I was wearing 25 years ago. It's faded a bit, and there are some holes sort of here and there, but I don't like buying new clothes much. I don't like throwing things away, I suppose, which they come in handy eventually, don't they? But I think we're eating less meat these days than we used to, and certainly we have one or two days a week with vegetarian food and fish, that kind of thing. So it's little things, isn't it? But yeah, solar panels, electric cars, yes, it's a major investment, isn't it? Yeah. I think the only thing I thought of was, I think if you look at the notice sheet, you might notice tea bags. And Evelyn has round tea bags because they're decaf. I have square tea bags. And I think, well, if you have a round tea bag, what happens to all the bits they cut off? Isn't that just waste? Whereas square ones, you don't have any waste. Over to you, Hazel. Come on. Put us right.
Good thinking, Tony. That's wonderful. So, tea bags was at the subject of my little thing on the notice sheet. I've had so many ideas, you know, running around my head. I've almost forgotten. But that's a really interesting article, and it actually pinpoints for you where to go and buy the stuff that you would like to buy as per tea bags. But my green idea this week that I'd like to share is, last week we needed to change a light bulb in a light fitting, and it was halogen. So we said, right, okay, we'll go LED with this light. And then I sort of wafted this light bulb around and thought, where do I put it? We used to recycle light bulbs, but somehow or other we don't anymore. So I had to get another bag out and stick it in the garage, and it's now got three halogen light bulbs in it. So it just shows that even if you've started off doing something in the everyday life, it might just have got lost, and sometimes we need to revisit. And you know, that's happened to me, I'm sure it happens to loads of people. So we are doing our light bulb, continuing with the light bulb order, changing them to LEDs and putting the light bulbs in the proper place at the Padworth tip, because we're West Berkshire.
It's funny, isn't it? Light bulbs are a bit like Jill's diesel car. I was going through my spare light bulbs, and I've got a pile of halogen bulbs and the old ones with a fluorescent tube all wound round and round and round, and we're on LEDs now. And I thought, well, what do I do with all these light bulbs? You know, they still work, I don't want them. So I'll offer them free rather than take them to Padworth and get them thrown away, I suppose. Yeah, anyway, food for thought for our coffee discussion. So I hope to see you on Zoom coffee. Stuart usually opens it up fairly soon after the service. So I hope to see many of you then. Have a blessed week, and we'll see you next week, some of us. So God bless. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.